all, for those who are visiting, I'm Father Alfredo Hernandez, the Rector President of San Vicente Paul Regional Seminary. Welcome as well to those who are watching on live stream. Before we begin tonight, just a reminder, certainly for our faculty who was not present this evening at evening prayer, that word that Senior Joe Cunningham, who was rector of San Vicente Paul from 1986 to 1991, passed away in Brooklyn today at noon. Ask you to please keep Senior Cunningham in prayer, and he was supposed to receive and will receive posthumously the San Vicente Paul Award next week at Fresno Seminary. And welcome to this event. Today in Tallahassee, Bishop Bill Walk celebrated the Mass of Thanksgiving for the closing of the diocesan phase of the cause of the Martyrs of La Florida Mission, the Servants of God, Antonio y Mija, and 56 companions. The investigations have offered sufficient evidence to ask the Dicastery for Saints to consider for beatification these 57 individuals. Among them lay Native Americans, priests, religious, even children, and an unborn child. Let us begin in prayer, and I will use the prayer for the beatification of the Servants of God, Antonio y Mija, and companions. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, Father of many nations, who through the grace of baptism have chosen us to be citizens of your one kingdom, you called Antonio y Mija and companions to accept your gift of faith, professing their hope in your only begotten Son. Help us with your grace to imitate their courage and humility in the face of suffering and death. May the blood of the martyrs of La Florida inspire our hearts to follow you without delay. And if it be your holy will, through the intercession of Antonio y Mija and companions, grant the request we hereby make. I invite you each to make a request of these martyrs, of the Lord in these martyrs' name. We make our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And before I introduce our speaker, allow me to read a letter that I was asked to write and to send to Bishop Walk to go to Rome, saying that our seminary supports the cause. This Reverend William A. Walk, Bishop of Pensacola, Tallahassee, Your Excellency. I write you to express my appreciation for the closing of the diocesan phase of the cause for the beatification of the martyrs of La Florida. I write an enthusiastic support for various reasons. As rector of Florida's interdiocesan seminary, I know how much the witness of these martyrs and the greater awareness of them among the faithful of the region will impact our seminarians. In fact, that the dedication and blessing of our new guest wing in 2015, it was dedicated to these martyrs with the hope that they would soon be beatified. We will be sending a delegation of seminarians in the propedeutic stage of formation together with their formator. I want these men, just beginning their time in seminary, to be able to witness this historic event. At the same time, we are planning an event here at the seminary that evening, the one you're at which Father Christian Sáenz, the church historian of the Caribbean province of the Jesuits, will speak on the significance of these martyrs. Being able to venerate all of these Christians as blessed Antonio y Mija companions will be a great boon in the formation of men called to be willing to spend their lives for Christ and his church. It is particularly appropriate for us in the seminary to be able to honor Father Agustin Ponce de Leon, OFM, who will be the first martyred priest to have been born in what is now the United States. He and many other priests in this group of martyrs would be a great example to our seminarians. The fact that most of those included in the cause are laity, including so many Native Americans, is also a great cause for wonder and could offer an impetus for evangelization. Their beatification could give a model to many lay people, and especially to Native American and Hispanic laity. For us at the seminary, we also see here models of collaboration among clergy, religious, and laity. The presence of children, and even an unborn child among those included in the cause, would be a powerful symbol at this time when the life of the unborn is so often not respected and the dignity of children is not valued. The words of St. Quadvultus in the sermon used as a second reading in the Office of Readings for the Feast of the Holy Innocents come to mind. Quote, "The child makes of those as yet unable to speak fit witnesses to himself," unquote. On a personal note, as a son of Cuban exiles, the inclusion of two Cuban Franciscans has great meaning for me. These would be the first beatified Cuban martyrs. Further, as a native Floridian, with two of my great-great-great-grandfathers having been born in St. Augustine, I very much look forward to the day when Floridians can venerate Antonio y Nihad companions. Be assured of my prayers on the day of the closing of the diocesan phase. I am aware that this event will take place on October 12th, the 531st anniversary of the discovery of the New World by Christopher Columbus. The Spanish crewmen must have been very aware that that day was the feast of Nuestra Señora del Pilar. May the Blessed Mother, pillar of faith, who accompanied St. James in his evangelization of Spain, and who has been the constant support of proclaimers of the gospel in the Americas, intercede for this intention as well. And now, to introduce our speaker, Father Christian Sáenz. There he is. I was just looking, there's some hard to see. Father Christian Sáenz, S.J., grew up in Miami. He attended Belen Preparatory School and went on to study international relations and Italian language at Syracuse University, where he had earned his BA in 2000. Having made his first vows as a Jesuit in what was then the province of the Antilles and is now the province of the Caribbean in 2004, he went on to earn an MA in philosophical resources from Fordham in 2006. And he has 3 degrees from the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome, Bachelor in Sacred Theology 2011, Licentiate in Church History 2015, and Doctorate in Church History. I really like how that doctorate, its initials are H-E-L. Doctorate in Church History from 2018. Since finishing his studies, he has been a chaplain at Belén, ecclesiastical director of the Agrupación Católica Universitaria, and since 2019, an adjunct faculty member here at St. Vincent de Paul, teaching church history and Latin. We are sorry and proud that we are losing him to return to his alma mater, the Pontifical Gregorian University, to begin teaching church history this coming January. We are very glad that he is able to honor us and give us our Theology Today address this evening, Father Sáenz.
Thank you very much, Father Rector, for inviting me to do this presentation of Theology Today. Even though my specialty is in early church history, my hobby is this, actually, the mission in Florida, and really specifically the Jesuit mission in Florida, well, for obvious reasons, perhaps. But I was very happy to have been asked to do this because lets me get things off my chest, things I've been thinking of for a while and doing a reading when I first discovered some of the original sources pertaining to the mission in Florida and especially the martyrs in Florida as well. And so certainly it's meaningful that we do this today on this feast of the Virgen del Pilar, a significant feast in Spain, but also to us in the New World on this anniversary of the arrival of America, which brought forth and ushered this continual mission that we still participate in today of these first missionaries that came to our shores in what was known as Florida. The process that is celebrated today as well with the ending of the diocesan phase and sending the cause to Rome for beatification is a process that in one way began centuries ago, as we heard just moments before we began, that Bishop Walk had mentioned that this is a process that's centuries in the making, but also that began in 1930s under Bishop John Mark Gannon from Erie, Pennsylvania. He began this push for the martyrs of the United States. And it also coincided with that time in Spain as well, that the letters and all the correspondence from those Jesuit missionaries in what was known as Florida were compiled and published as well in the 1930s. I found that volume when I was in Rome, and it had a layer of dust on it. So it meant nobody really had opened that book. And so I was very happy to take it and look through it as much as I could, and was able to get a scanned version for myself. It's not something I could pack easily and bring along, and it's out of print as well. But that process continued in 2015, as we heard, when Bishop Gregory Parks as well opened the cause in Tallahassee, and most recently, just last year, Bishop William Mock of Pensacola, Tallahassee, also sent the names now of these martyrs that gave credible witness as well. So we're dealing with 57 martyrs in total, and amongst them, three Dominicans. We heard one from San Juan de Dios from the Order of St. John of God, and amongst them, Franciscans as well, Jesuits, and laymen and laywomen, and even the unborn. And so for 57 lives, I can't really give 57 minutes. That would be 1 minute each. So we're going to focus on actually just a sliver of those. We're going to focus on the Jesuit martyrs in there, and specifically on those who made it to the peninsula of Florida. And it's a little problematic because what was meant by Florida back then is not exactly what we mean by Florida today. The map has changed quite a bit. And so I'd like to look at what exactly can we learn from the experience, not just of the martyrs, but the missionaries as well. What can we learn from that mission to which they belong? And a lot of it will be taken from one that's not a martyr, but that left a great record of missionary activity, Brother Francisco Villarreal, who did accompany the first martyr, Father Pedro Martinez. And we'll take a look at about him and the profile of who was selected to come to this mission. Unfortunately for our Jesuit martyrs, they didn't really get enough time to mission. They were essentially killed when they were right off the boat. However, those that did survive would give us a good idea of what we could have probably expected and what they hoped to do, accomplish in that brief time here on our shores. And so let's take a look, and here we have perhaps one of the more recent acts of devotion that was done in our chapel in the Belen Jesuit in Miami. Was commissioned, was actually consecrated not too long ago. One of the chapels are commissioned for the Florida martyrs, and here we have two only. We have Father Pedro Martinez, which would have been the first Jesuit martyr, and Father Juan Bautista de Segura, who led the last mission in Florida and was also a martyr in that last missionary push. And so they're commemorated in this painting that's in that chapel. So let's take a look exactly what are we talking about when we say La Florida, that Spanish province, because the map, again, was quite different. What was considered La Florida stretched from what are the Martyr Islands, which are today the Florida Keys, going up to where is Mission Santa Elena, which is more or less today in South Carolina, and blending somewhere into what is called Ayacan or Ayacan, which is North Carolina, going into Chesapeake Bay. Basically, parts of North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida were considered Florida. And so when we hear about the missionaries of La Florida, we got to think of a very vast, expansive territory. Sometimes, depending on who was writing, Cuba would be also figured into that same province as well. So it was a vast territory and mostly unknown. And that was one of the challenges, that we've got a good map now, but the maps they had back then didn't quite catch it. Juan Ponce de León, who was the first to really explore Florida, really thought it was an island, and still we see in the correspondence of these missionaries treating Florida as if it were an insula, it was still an island. They did know it was connected to a larger continent yet. We have, working in this vast area, the first to step off, we'd say, were the order of preachers, the Dominicans. And so we have Father Cáncer, was the one of the first martyrs, one of the first martyrs, we can say, that was there. It was a Dominican friar that had come off. He begins his own mission, kind of a mission with a few others with him, although we don't know much about it. Father Cáncer had actually passed around through different parts of the Caribbean before ending up on the west coast of Florida. And so there was an initial presence of Dominicans, but it was very short-lived, that first mission. The second group that would have come in were the Society of Jesus, were the Jesuits. And there were three missionary initiatives that happened in this territory. The third group, of course, and the largest, were the Franciscans. And they were the most successful, actually. The Order of Friars Minor, the Franciscans, concentrated their missionary activity to what is northern Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina today. And their missions lasted. However, that was the third, we can say, overall attempt, and was the most successful. There's something to be said about that. It's a study as well as something I'd like to look into in the future. Exactly what was it about the Franciscan mission that gave it success, whereas the other two prior attempts weren't very successful? The Jesuits, at the end, actually abandoned the Florida mission. They asked to be excused, and they do leave. Of course, there was a presence of laity as well, and precisely laymen. In the letters we hear from Spain, they're referred to as mancebos. Now, mancebo, if we look it up, crudely, the definition is a servant. And so we see that these were men who were in service, that were offering service. We can imagine doing some of the heavy lifting or some of the manual work that was related to the missionary to the missionary initiative. They might be the ones who loaded the ships, unloaded the ships. They might have been cooks. They might have been handymen, basically, also building some of the shelters or providing support work for the missionaries. And so with that missionary parting, you hear these mancebos are mentioned, rather. They themselves were not missionaries per se. They were strictly there for a support role. And we'll see that the mission really is a greater enterprise than just the missionaries or the clerical presence. Also, walking around these areas was an army. And so Philip II's army, Spanish, that was composed of Spanish and Flemish troops as well, made their way here and served as an escort, an armed escort, for the missionaries, especially the Jesuits. Later on, we shed that escort, and we realized that it's probably not the best combination. But nevertheless, they were there. And the interesting thing is, it was not just Spanish, it was also a Flemish component that was here. Families as well, so more laymen and laywomen that were related to the Spanish government or that presence of the government here in Florida, would have been also settlers as well. And some of them were also part of the mission as well, and they gave their witness. Native neophytes, natives who were baptized as well, would have been part of that mission component. And so they did rely a lot on some of the newly baptized to help translate and also spread the gospel. And some of our martyrs are amongst those native neophytes as well. And also, before any of these arrive, the French. We have French explorers and troops, but not just any French explorer troop. We have the Huguenots. If you recall what this name is, it refers really to Calvinists. So French Protestants who had come here first and had made an initial contact before. We'll see that the mission in Florida is really requested as a response to the French having gotten here before anybody else. And so let's take a look at the preparation for the mission. The missions were something that required a lengthy preparation, and was quite detailed, and it took its time, actually. It took several years to put together. And we can see two faces in here that give us this this notion of preparation. One is Father Cáncer, that's on the other side, the Dominican friar that made his way here. Remember that Father, cancer had actually started from moving from Spain to what's today the Dominican Republic, the island of Hispaniola, and also eventually made his way to Puerto Rico, to Mexico, what was called New Spain back then, and Central America, precisely to Honduras, Guatemala. He was in there. He actually comes to Florida from Mexico, missioning, in the spirit of Bartolomé de los Casas, who was working a lot and preached a lot for the dignity of the indigenous that were encountered in this new world. He would have led, we would say, that first, but rather kind of unofficial missionary mission to Florida, going to the west coast, just a little bit below Tampa, basically. Branson, basically, is where this where he would be, where he would have landed. And makes several visits to there, however, dies on one of those visits, unfortunately. But after him, and his death is known amongst some of the other missionaries, or at least in Spain, it's heard about, we don't have another initiative until the Jesuits come in. And that's why I have here, Father, at that moment, Father Francis Borja, later St. Francis Borja, also from the Borja family, related to the famous Borgias. And he is the one who initiates the mission in Florida, but at an official level. We see that to have a mission actually required a royal decree. It was an official act of the government. And at this time, we have to recall that the missions were actually confided by the Pope to the sovereign, to the King of Spain, being the Catholic King of Spain. So it is a mission that is undertaken by the King as a Catholic King, and he then delegates and decides who goes where. And Florida would have been sent, being requested of the Jesuits at this moment. And so we do have a royal decree that officially asks the Jesuits, specifically at this moment, St. Francis Borja. He was the vicar general. The general had died, and they hadn't yet selected a new father general. He would eventually be selected as a new father general. But at that time, as his vicar, he receives the royal request, the official request, for the Jesuits to go to Florida. And so it was not so much a request as it was an order by the king. And so we would have later a phase of selection. It wasn't just any volunteer got to go. No, you were selected. You were invited to come. And it also entails a specific process that is proper to the Jesuits and is still exercised today of discernment and selection of who goes on missions, especially missions related that originate from the Holy See or from the Pope. That selection and that royal decree, again, initiated an official process. That also required specific funds. And so the royal purse was going to fund this. It was the mission of the king, and he took it on as a personal initiative. And so he would also cover the expenses of the missionaries. And so expenses such as cassocks, bedding, food, the flour and the wine used for the liturgy, the guard that would accompany them, transportation, books, altar linens, anything the missionary would need would be at the cost of the king. And that was very important because, well, the king is pretty generous. And so what they did get were, they did take advantage of that and got all brand new cassocks, as we hear in some of the letters, as they were being fitted, new berettas as well, brand new missiles. They were ready for their mission. It was good to go on mission. It was a bad setup. It's interesting, in the back we have, in these letters, you'll see the inventory of what was asked. Every missionary was given two cassocks, a new beretta as well. Yes, the missiles were bought. Some of the other appointments were donated as well by benefactors. And so we hear about boxes of rosaries being given to the missionaries by certain families, as well as crucifixes to be handed out to the natives that they encounter. And so it was a large enterprise. Not just the government was involved officially, but also the lady, the Church of the Faithful, were also involved as well in supplying this this mission. The reason for the mission, and here's where kind of politics sometimes gets in, the official reason, we see it in the letter that is sent by the king to his to the father general, or at that time the vicar, was to primarily act against Huguenot first contact. He says, that's it, the people and the possible faithful that are in Florida have already been touched by Protestantism, and we need to work against it. And so that becomes really the motivation for the king to move on. And he wants, and in his words, counteract Lutheranism. They weren't Lutheran, actually, no, they were Calvinists. But again, terms were being thrown around all over the place at this time. There was also a problem in this preparation because they didn't quite know the geography of where they were going. They still thought, for the most part, and we see it in the correspondence, that they were in Asia. And so even the Adelantado, Pedro Menendez Avias, writes to Father General saying, oh, China is just north of us. I'm sure if you march for a couple of days, you will be in China. And if you sail for a couple of days east, you should be around Norway. He had no idea where he was going. The proposal was even given to them to say, well, you know, Peru is just south of there. I'm pretty sure, why don't they service both of them? And you can go back and forth from Peru to Florida. It's just right there. They have no idea where they were. And so that becomes a limiting factor because we will, it's a constant theme that they're lost when they're here because they really don't know where they're standing. But it's under this Jesuit later general that it is. And that painting, incidentally, is taken also from the chapter of Lenin. We kind of wanted to make this callback to that participation, even though St. Francis Borgia never stepped foot outside of Europe. We have him here on the shores of Biscayne Bay with a ship that would have dropped the missionaries there on that painting also in at Belen. And so let's take a look at the timeline. Once we have this process and how long it took for it to come together, because what leads up to this martyrdom and, well, to this mission again that we had inherited ourselves, how's the starting point? We say May 9th, 1565. We'll call that the starting point. Because as the king has formally requested, so does the governor of Florida at that time, Pedro Menendez de Aviles, he's called the Adelantado, writes to Father Borgia saying, well, I've got the king's request as well, and I would like to request these missionaries in the name of King Philip II. And as a result, then the vicar at that time, Father Borgia, forwards it to the provincials of Spain, asking them to nominate candidates to go to Florida. And so we begin a discernment process of who would be the best candidate to go in response to its mission. That's in May of 1565, and by October, we finally have a list of candidates. In October of 1565, three candidates are nominated to go to the mission with one assistant priest who has already been named, Father Juan Rogel, and one brother to help in other matters, Brother Francisco Villarreal. Those three candidates are basically alternates. Their favorite was an older priest, actually, who unfortunately, well because of questions of age and health, declined. And so he was given right of first refusal, so to say. And they moved on to their second choice. However, their second choice was already on his way to Peru. And that was the one they said, well, can he just go back and forth? And boy, it got back to them that that's not possible. You know, he's in Peru, he's staying in Peru. So they go to their third choice, which takes us to our future martyr, Father Pedro, Martinez. Father Martinez is nominated in November of 1565 as the superior of the mission. And again, he was pretty much the third string candidate. And he responds overwhelmingly, yes, I'm ready to go. Yes, I've got the health and I've got the desire to go to this mission. And so now we've got a missionary party that is really made of three Jesuits, of Father Martinez, Father Rogel, and Brother Villarreal. In April of the following year, of 1566, we begin the movement to go on the mission. And so Father Martinez, who actually, and we'll see him a little bit later, begins leaving where he was in central Spain. He begins moving down to southern Spain, to a port, to Sevilla, and then to the port of departure, San Lucar, which is near Jerez de la Frontera, southern Spain, but going towards the Atlantic area. And so he begins that movement, which takes him several months to get to. While he is moving there, he is also collecting supplies, also receiving donations for the mission as well. And Father Rogel and Brother Villarreal also begin to leave their mission where they were currently sent and make their way to the port. And so, of course, distances and transportation back there was a little bit difficult. Very important that, and this is a series of letters that go between the provincials and Father General to make sure they have what in Spanish are called cédulas. They need their cédula. Cédula, again, if you look it up, it means an ID, but really what we're talking about is a royal license for permission to go to the New World. You just couldn't get on a boat and leave. And so they needed, we would call it an exit visa today, is really what it was. And these licenses were issued for the missionaries. And it looks like they were taking a while to get to them. There was a consistent worry that they not arrive to the port before having those licenses with them, because the licenses granted you something else and allow you to charge things to the royal purse. It was their official, hey, this is, send it to the king. And so without that, and we see the worry is, you know, the king said he's going to pay for this. We're not paying for this. And so with those royal licenses, they can present themselves to the ship, and these are the guys who are going to get it right out. And they can also start charging things, again, bedding, supplies, food, put it all and send it to the king. He will reimburse you. And so it was, again, a very formal and a very organized process that was going on. That was in April. By June, we finally arrived, the licenses arrived, and we have all the three missionaries arrive at San Lucar, at the port of departure. And there's, look at what began in May in 1565. In June of 1566, just a little over a year, it took for them to actually get ready. And so it was a long process that had to be thought out, and also perhaps a little tedious. These missionaries get to their departure port, and Father Martinez, interestingly enough, makes his religious profession then and there. He had not made final vows yet, and in that correspondence, we see that final vows are to be granted to him only upon validation that he's ready to get on that ship. When he's ready to get on that ship, they give him his four vows. Fourth vow of special obedience to the Pope, because he's about to exercise it right there. So again, it tells us who is being selected, who is going, and the importance of the mission, because Ignatius's preference at the time was for the missionaries to be of four vows. They're supposed to be model Jesuits, and Jesuits that could continue the order wherever they are, and so he was going to be the first Jesuit in Florida. He would be the superior of any future Jesuits in Florida. So he does his religious profession the day before departure and gets on the ship, and he's out, and his provincial's there to make sure he's on that ship. Might beg the question, I guess some of them didn't make it on the ship. And so they might have gone through this before at some point. It's Pope Pius V who gives special missionary faculties. They arrive right on time also for their departure with his apostolic blessing. But the interesting thing is, and it's detailed again in these letters, because there is a juridical aspect to the mission as well that has to be thought out and understood. Certain missionary faculties, which still today are granted to missionaries, faculties that are for the absolution of reserved sins, sins that only the Holy Father can absolve, or require one to go to the penitentiary and ask for penance. There is a special concession given to missionaries that should they encounter any of these reserved sins, they do not have to go to the Holy Father, they do not have to go to the penitentiary. Obviously, it's very hard for that communication to go. They're given faculties to go ahead and absolve everything. And so that's a special missionary faculty that's granted right there to Father Martinez and Father Rogel on their way out. Remember that Brother Villarreal was not a priest. And also for certain reserved sins in extremis, in the moment of death, again, they can go ahead and impart the apostolic blessing. They don't have to ask permission or anything to go in. Aside from this as well, a plenary indulgence would be granted to any penitent that approaches them in mission. And so if you go to confession with any of these missionaries, plenary indulgence is also included in the package in there. And so they were loaded in many different aspects on the way out. Pope Pius V is interesting because if you go to some of the churches in the in especially Jesu Church in Miami, you'll find a statue of Pope Pius V and of St. Francis Borgia, recalling that those, you know, it was the reigning pontiff at the time. He was recently elected, actually. He would have been elected around February of that year, of 1566. So this is his first mission as well. He's sending it out, his missionaries, very shortly after being elected pope. And in September of 1566 is when the missionaries finally arrive. So it's quite a while. Now, it doesn't take, if they didn't go nonstop all the way across the Atlantic. They stopped first in several Spanish ports before crossing over to the Canary Islands. From the Canary Islands, they stayed about a week. Father Martinez decided to become chaplain, basically, of the port, and so he did attend to the crew that was at port and anybody else who got near the ship as well. And then they finally did the long run out across the Atlantic. It was quite interesting that it was a long shot across the Atlantic. They more or less knew once they would see the land, try to figure out where they were. And so their first land sighting was Puerto Rico. It was at that time called San Juan Island. And they figured they were in Puerto Rico. They were already navigating through the Virgin Islands. And their stop, their initial stop was gonna be Cuba. However, here's where they depart, and it was a flotilla that went out. Part of the flotilla went to Cuba, and the one going to Florida went straight across to Florida. They didn't stop for the whole time. So it was a pretty long and arduous journey to go across sea land, but not really get out during that time. The missionary party makes landfall somewhere near Jacksonville. It's believed near the mouth of the St. John's River. And that's where they encounter martyrdom. So they don't really get a good chance. Now, there was a little bit of confusion that happened in this missionary, in this trip. They were actually trying to find a mission further north, St. Santa Elena, that's around that border of Georgia and South Carolina. They were disoriented. They saw the Florida coastline. However, the pilot that was guiding their ship wasn't familiar. It was the first time he had come to Florida. So they told him, go look for a fort. The fort was St. Augustine. He couldn't find it. And so it is said from that correspondence we hear in St. Augustine, they saw the ship, they fired a cannon, they tried to make all this noise, but they just passed them. They didn't see them. And the ship kept on wandering north. When they encounter some rough seas and they put in, they do realize that they can see their settlements on the shore. And it's a very interesting thing because the maps they leave show that the Florida coastline was completely inhabited from south as far as Miami, all the way up the coastline. There were evidence of tribes and tribal settlements, the entire coastline. And so the challenge is set out to get ashore and try to ask for directions, is what they did. See, which way is St. Augustine? Everyone needs to know where that castle is. And so the decision was made to go on shore. They can see that there was some natives on shore and ask which way we're supposed to go. And it was a little difficult because the soldiers didn't want to go. There was a natural fear of what could go in there. I mean, they had made this long trip for them. It was the first time ever coming in here. And so they pretty much said, if the priest doesn't go, we're not going to go. And so they looked at the priests, at the two priests, and it was Father Martin says, I'll go. I'm the superior of this mission, so let's go. I'm the first one off. And so he steps off. He's the first one to come off. The soldiers follow at a distance from him as he encounters and starts making contact with the indigenous there. They did more or less know where St. Augustine was. It said, go south. You want to go that way. But while they were figuring this out, the boat that left the landing party gets caught in winds and leaves them. And so now they're stranded, the landing party. Father Rogel and Brother Villarreal are still on the ship. And they get blown off course, and they see them just leave. And so the question is whether to stay or to go. From what they understood was that St. Augustine wasn't that far away, maybe a couple of days' walk, and they can get there. And so they begin their way south. As they're going, Father Martinez, well, begins his mission. However, his mission was really with the soldiers that were with him, that were freaking out this whole time. We already hear him about his stories on the ship, that he was celebrating Mass in the ship, hearing confessions on the ship in Spanish and in Flemish. Apparently he picked up Flemish in the time that he made an effort to minister to the Flemish soldiers that were there as well. And on land, he set up a crude altar for himself and began saying Mass and set up a crucifix. Wherever he would walk, he carried. He was both crucifer and priest at the same time, carrying the cross wherever he went, and was the point of initial contact with the indigenous he found. However, it wasn't looking pretty good, because the further south he got, he would notice that the natives in the towns would run the minute they see them. Now, it probably didn't help that he had an army behind him when he was going there. And so it was a little bit off-putting. They were leaving abandoning places. He would leave some of those crucifixes or rosaries behind in the towns as a token of goodwill as they kept on moving down. Until finally at the mouth of one of the rivers, and they had run out of food, they had run out of water, they come in, and again, a curious indigenous tribe looks at who they were. They cannot communicate too well, and the soldiers get a little antsy about this. They notice they start looking around through their stuff, they start taking their things, and a fight starts between the soldiers and the indigenous, and well, the indigenous win. And so Father Martinez is martyred at that moment in there. We don't have any image of how Father Martinez looked like. This is the first lithograph that was done in the 1600s in one of the martyrologies of the Jesuits that you can find in Rome. And so we have one of the indigenous, but you can see, if you look at it closely, you know, we've got the palm trees, that's true, but there's a mountain range. There's no mountain range in Jacksonville. So again, they didn't know where they were. And Father Martinez, who is, we hear, was dunked underwater, almost drowned, and then smacked in the head with a club, and was left dead on the shore in there. When that happens, the soldiers run, and they leave Father Martinez behind, and they eventually make it to St. Augustine and tell what happened in there. In the meantime, the problem was that the ship that had the other two missionaries was so far off course, they turned around and went back to Cuba. They didn't know where they were at all. So it was kind of a mission failure in one sense, that poor Father Martinez really didn't get a chance to start his mission. It was almost as soon as he stepped off the ship, he endured martyrdom. And there was no settlement that was done. So it was almost an abortive mission, what happened. Let's take a little bit of Father Pedro Martinez, first of all, and notice you see it in Latin, it says P. Petrus Martinez, the Latinization of his name. Remember when we see P, it means pater, father, padre, Pedro Martinez. When you see an F, it doesn't mean father, it means frater, brother. And so there's a little a mistake that some of our contemporaries have in classifying the two. Who was this first martyr that dies on the shores of northern Florida? He was born in 1533, born in a town called Sella or Cella in Teruel, Spain, in Aragon, and probably in a part where they do speak Catalan. And in 1553, so when he's 20 years old, he finishes philosophy studies in Valencia and makes first vows in the Jesuits. And so we don't quite have seminaries yet, or formation was not quite organized at this moment. And so it was most likely he went to the Jesuit college in Valencia, was taking the standard courses for a liberal arts degree at that time, which included philosophy, and his professors were Jesuits, and he decided to enter the Society of Jesus right after there. After pronouncing vows, he goes to Valencia to commence theology right away, after his novitiate, of course. And so in 1558, and it's rather quickly, he's ordained as a priest in Murcia in southern Spain, where he serves as a military chaplain for a couple of years in northern Africa. And so he's already used to being on campaign. He's already used to a rough life in a certain way, to being on the move and mission. So we can imagine he stepping on that ship with these soldiers. He's been there before. He's kind of knowing what he was getting into at the same time. Between 1563 and 1565, Father Martinez is named minister of college in 1560 to 1563. He goes back to Spain from northern Africa and continues theological studies, higher studies in Salamanca, the premier university in Spain. And probably on account of those same studies, he is named minister of the college in Valladolid, and shortly after rector, the year after, rector of the college in Monterrey, Spain as well. And so this is when he's approached to be a missionary. He's the rector of the college. He's done advanced studies in theology already. And this opportunity to go to this place that no one's been before, Florida, comes up. Already two that were asked before him said, no, we're not the men for the job. And so he's the one who says yes. Now, if we look at our math and we look at our years, born in 1533, dies in 1566, he would have been in his 30s when he dies, rather young. He was chaplain to the Florida Expeditionary Party, so we would say his first job as a missionary was to the missionary party that was there in port and at sea. And so he takes an active role both in the Canary Islands and on the ship, leading litanies all day, saying daily mass aboard the ship for the crew, and also guiding others in the prayer of the office and readings as well. And they mentioned again how relevant it was that he was doing this also in Flemish. Again, he's the first to step off and martyred shortly after 1566, somewhere right after the Feast of the Holy Cross. We know they step off on the 14th of September. It was the Feast of the Holy Cross when he steps off. And it's quite perhaps significant or meaningful that he begins his walk to Calvary at the same day of the Feast of the Holy Cross, shortly after a couple of days. Now, that first mission ends rather abruptly with Father Martinez. So the other two went back to Cuba to figure everything out. There were two subsequent missions to Florida, at least one with a greater success. Father Martinez's his martyrdom resonates throughout Spain, and it was quite a shock to see this very well-formed Jesuit, young Jesuit, full of vigor, that was, you know, all the preparation that was going either from the king and the investment he made in the mission, also from the part of the Society of Jesus, go, and the news that we get back from mission is that he died just shortly after touching land. On one level, we see a lot of correspondence from younger Jesuits who want to volunteer and go in and take his place. But on the other hand, now Father General Borgia, who's been elected, thinks otherwise. He urges caution and rather wants to rethink the whole way of proceeding. In his way of looking at it, he just lost a man. And in his granting him and selecting him for to go on this mission, he sent him to his death. And it's something that weighs on his conscience for many years afterwards. In the correspondence, he writes, we are not conquistadors. And so, rather, let's wait until Florida is pacified by the military, and then we'll go. In fact, the Peru mission is probably better, because that one apparently was already pacified. And so he's like, maybe we should think about Peru instead. Forget about Florida for the moment. He also rewrites how missions should go. And he writes in Spanish, tomar noticia de la tierra, gente, costumbres, y modo de cómo se deben convertir a conocimiento de la verdad. In other words, when the missionaries arrive there, perhaps first they should be observers. Explore. See what the land is, what the people are, what are their customs, and then we can best determine how they are to be shown the truth in there. And so there was this urge of caution. That second mission in 1567 goes to Southwest Florida, which is known as Calus, or the country of the Calusa tribe in there, and to the Tequesta, which were related to that same tribe, and to a place called Ahakan, which is again North Carolina, going all the way up into Maryland as well. 1567, just 1 year after Father Martin's mission, the push is to go again rather cautiously into these lands. Now, prior contact had been established. It was the missionaries, both Villarreal and Rogel, mentioned that they ran into representatives from Florida that lived in Cuba. So there was already traffic or movement between the tribes in Florida and Cuba. They were very close already together. And that's where they have this invitation by some of those that are on Cuba to go and visit where their homeland is, just across the way of Florida Straits. And so they take up that invitation. Father Rogel goes to Brother Villarreal goes to Tequesta, which was based in what is today Miami. And Father Cedeño and Alamos and another brother go around to find St. Helena again. So they go the long way around. And these missionaries eventually go back to Cuba at one point for resupply, and they don't come back. And so the mission is abandoned one time. But from that mission, especially in the north, five natives go to Spain. They're presented to the king. They're catechized in the Jesuit school, and they're baptized as well. One decides to come back, the other four remain and stayed in Spain. And that led to the third missionary push in 1568 to 1571. There was one more expedition to Ahakan, again to that northern part, but the native representative that came there kind of turned against them. Unfortunately leads the other natives there to massacre the missionary party as soon as it lands. And there, about 11 Jesuits come out, and only one of the mancebos, one of the servants who were there, survives and tells the story of what happened. After that massacre, Father Borja is rather reluctant to send anybody else to the mission in Florida, and formally retracts and asks the king to relieve them of that charge, and the Jesuits don't go back to Florida from there. It's the Franciscans who will take up the mission from then on and are rather successful, actually, in northern Florida. Just really quickly, I wanted to see what the mission would have looked like, because we do have the chronicle of one of the missionaries, Father Francisco Villarreal, who gave the best chronicle of a mission in Florida. We don't have a picture of him, but Winwood Brewery has an idea of what he would have looked like. And this is who they call, a little bit with an air of Father Francisco. No, he's Brother Francisco. They unfortunately saw the Latinized entry, F. Francisco Villarreal, which stood for frater. They assumed it meant father. And so they did make a beer with his name on it, but he was not father, so they ordained him posthumously. But it's interesting what he was. He was a lone missionary in Miami. Who arrived in 1567, and he had a sizable military escort with him. And he relates that daily he would teach basic catechesis. He was just kind of dumped there alone. And again, he wasn't a priest, so he was limited basically to catechesis. And his catechesis, he said, I taught them as best I could the Ten Commandments so they can repeat them to me in Spanish and try to understand or how to translate that into their language. learn some of the basic Our Fathers, Glory Be's. The Creed, he got halfway through it, he wasn't able to get through. But he did say that he was a little reluctant because he was limited to 15-year-olds, to children. It seemed that they would leave the children to them, but the adults weren't very interested in what he had to say. He would teach twice, one in the morning, once in the afternoon, and would employ plays to teach children some moral lessons. And this is actually from the Jesuit playbook of using drama as a way of teaching. He does lead processions and litanies, and this is where he writes is very interesting. He says, what most people is bring the sick to me, bring the dying to me, and well, I don't know what to do. I pray over them. I don't anoint them, because I'm not ordained, you know, so I'm not supposed to do that, but I do all the prayers that I can. And he prays over the sick, gives the dead a Christian burial, and baptizes only the dying. He's a little reluctant of baptizing anyone who doesn't quite understand what he's teaching yet. And so, again, in extremis, he is given the faculty to baptize, and he does do it several times in Miami. He does suffer malnutrition. He doesn't eat, and it seems that he does mention there's not a lot of food in Miami. Every now and then, they might get a sea turtle, but that's not enough for everybody, and he looked at it and said, I'm not touching that. And they do know that they would go to what's probably Key Biscayne today to look for coconuts and all that, but they would bring coconuts for themselves, not for him. And so all he had was some flour and the wine for eventually a mass whenever the missionary priest would come, which never arrived. And the soldiers were looking at him and said, we want to eat that instead. Eventually he's relieved. The ship comes and picks them up for more supplies, and he leaves. But when they find him in Cuba, the provincial takes pity on him and says, I can't send you back there. You look terrible. He also confesses for a lack of sleep because the mosquitoes are relentless. And well, yeah, anyone who's been around here long enough outside can attest to that. I think we are at time, or do we have time for it? All right. And so we can open up the questions, but certainly I'd like to end for a moment just with a brief prayer that we could say in honor of this occasion, of this day, and the martyrs that it represents. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Almighty Lord, whose Holy Mother brought you into the world and into the new world on this day, may we who offer the testimony of the martyrs who graced our land be worthy heirs of their mission and cultivate the seed that was planted with the blood on our shores. We ask this through Christ our Lord, confiding always in his blessed mother. Hail Mary, full of grace.
Grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary.
So if you raise your hand, I will come to you with the microphone. I have a question. First, though, is the beer any good?
It was actually pretty strong.
So, questions for Father Sáenz.
Father, thank you for the presentation. You mentioned that Father Francis Borgia took it very to heart, the martyrdom of this missionary. At what point do missionaries or fathers general understand that to send on mission is most probably martyrdom?
Yeah, it comes out in that correspondence. In the life of St. Francis Borgia, his secretary's writing, he devotes quite a lot to it, saying that the death, not only of Father Martinez, but of the missionary party in the third mission, where everybody got wiped out. Again, he took that to heart. He felt personally responsible for sending men, as he put it in his own words, a certain death. And those are the words he mentions to the king. I will not send more men to a certain death when so little is being taken out. Certainly, when one is missioned there, and we can see it perhaps even in the mindset of Father Martinez as much as we can, it was a one-way ticket. They knew that you go there and you either are successful or you die trying. And that's what they did. We saw what the cost of success was, or at least partial success with the brother of Villarreal. The same could be said of the Calus mission also with Father Rogel. It wasn't that easy. His was a little bit nicer in the sense of where he was, but certainly it was a very hard thing. And when they see Brother Villarreal in Cuba, emaciated, the provincial says, I can't do this to you again. Let's figure this out better. And so even though it's understood that you are signing up for this, the weight of it is not to be dismissed easily. And certainly the leadership at that time was very conscious of that.
Thank you.
Dr. Ballstone first. Thank you, Father. That was very good.
Thank you.
My question is, when is there a more permanent mission in Miami? I know it doesn't stay.
Yeah.
Unfortunately,
yeah, Brother Villarreal's mission was the only one. It was abandoned. When he goes back to Cuba, he stays in Cuba. Father Rogel eventually goes back to Spain, and they don't come back to South Florida. Part of the reason, what I surmise, is really the Crown did not have an interest in South Florida, and so there was no reason. Even the soldiers, Brother Villarreal said, we were getting antsy to leave. And so, there was a desire to leave. And they don't resume it for many years, for centuries perhaps after.
Obviously a different context, but I know we're also trying to engage the world, the culture with the gospel. And so I'm just curious, in your research, have you seen any strategies or tactics that were very successful in sharing the gospel that we can learn from as we try to engage the culture today?
Yeah, certainly I would say the cause for study would be the Franciscans. Why did their mission persevere? And what was it about that's something I'd like to look at myself. Certainly we see that at least this first tactic that we see with the example of Martyrs probably wasn't the best. And this is why I like to see Brother Villarreal's example. It was almost, maybe because of his limitation, he was more open and more perhaps willing to encounter and kind of be led in there. Again, he did as much as he could. Not being ordained, he lived his call to our universal vocation to the priesthood as much as he could in there. And so certainly I think that's to be seen how that should be the first push in there before we're thinking about baptizing everyone you see. He was quite reluctant to do that, and I think it with good sense.
Thank you, Father.
Pass the mic back, please.
Can I ask one question? Can you briefly give an account of servant of God Antonio's martyrdom and his companions?
Of the other, of the Franciscans?
Right.
Unfortunately, I didn't get that far. I was sort of limiting to the Jesuits.
Thank you, Father. Was there perhaps, in your studies, any of these martyrs or saints, or in the mission itself, that you perhaps related to the most? As a historian, you sometimes are reading and you're like, well, I relate with this particular person more than another.
Brother Villarreal. I really get, perhaps because his chronicle's the most detailed. When they wrote letters about what they were doing, it wasn't that they were gonna mail them that same day. They were really diaries, is what they were, that eventually would get sent out whenever there was a ship. And so he was essentially writing his diary, what he would do every day. And it reminded me of when I was in formation myself, doing apostolate. Because, I would always say, I'm living my call to the priesthood as much as I can right now. And if it meant just doing catechesis, RCIA, whatever, well, that was it. And I saw him doing the exact same thing. He writes and asks on one of them, he's like, I'm praying over the sick. I'm basically saying the prayers for the anointing without anointing them. I don't know if I should be doing that, but I'm doing it anyway. And I'm baptizing this way. I'm not sure if this is the right way, but let me know if I'm doing it right or wrong. I'm still doing it. And he almost takes it into his own hands, but acting as much as he could in his capacity. So yeah, I'd say, Rian, have a nice beer as well.
Yes, Father, thank you for the presentation. We have a collaborative question back here. The first part of the question is, what constitutes martyrdoms? I know this isn't the only case, but Father Martinez, he dies, mm-hmm. not necessarily because he was preaching something, but because of the circumstances that he was in, most likely some sort of misunderstanding, mm-hmm. right? And yet we still consider him a martyr. And the second part of the question, Sister Claire, has to do with the timing, right?
Yes, it's so similar to certainly Father Martinez being there, and then, but then some being there a little longer. And then what was the mindset of having such a big span over years of having all the martyrs put together in one for this event?
Oh yeah, certainly. We see right after, and when we have the account of the martyrdom, and when we, if you read the chronicles of it, I mean, it does bring up the odium fidei, this hate of the faith, and the way, especially when the crucifixes and all the holy effects were smashed or robbed, and so it was classified, it was seen that way as an hate of the faith. And certainly the time frame takes a while. During that time, it was, they were already speaking of martyrs without having formally gone through any process in there. It was already been spoken. However, no formality had been sought for centuries, really until now. Although one thing that does come out of here that I would say is like almost like a pastoral challenge or something that jumps out is the language in which the natives of Florida are referred to before the missions, and even right up to Father Martinez's writing. It was a very optimistic language. They were talking about souls, about those ears who have not heard yet heard the gospel, about those souls who are craving to hear about the Lord and be close to the Lord. When the news of the martyrdom comes in and the way it was done, and then especially with the third party that gets massacred, the language completely changes. The savages that are there, the heathen, those soulless that are in Florida, that catches on. And so the perception of the native Floridians becomes very negative after that. So much to the point that even Father Francis Borges is affected by it. He's like, why are we gonna waste more time with them? They obviously are not ready for the gospel. And so it does completely change the perception that was there, which I think is one of these challenges that we have when we run into pastoral difficulties, which they certainly did.
Father, I have a question actually. As a priest of St. Augustine, mm-hmm. I'd like to know, that was established shortly before these Jesuit missions began. So in September 1565 is when the mission Nombre de Dios was established in St. Augustine, and that is the longest continuously settled area in Florida. So was there thought among the Jesuits of using that as a base, since that was already settled and stable? I think there were Franciscans actually. So was there any discussion of, that could be a place where we could fan out from?
It's strange. I think perhaps that mission would have been given then to the Franciscans, because they keep on mentioning Santa Elena as where they're trying to get to, and that becomes their base. And again, since the missions were conceded by the king, it may very well be the case that the Franciscans, you keep saying St. Augustine, Jesuits, you've got something else. And that's why they kept on trying to find this Santa Elena place. But other than that being a supply post where they can rally again, it seemed that their mission territory was somewhere else.
Finally, here at St. Vincent Paul, we are trying to form missionary disciples. Mm-hmm. And this came up in a previous question to an extent, but also, what can we do above all now to effectively bring the gospel to a culture that needs to be re-evangelized?
Yeah, certainly the challenge of the hostility, I think, is there. There is a certain hostility to that message. So, but perhaps we can also take that that first listening, that first observing, seeing what's there, and then little by little engaging. Certainly, I mean, we can say, that's why I kept on saying, we are the heirs of this mission, in a way, in the same land, in the same area, that they are, and that mission stays for us. How to approach that when some are unwilling, some might even turn against us. Certainly that, I would say, perhaps the greater lesson is the perseverance, the one that we didn't see with the Jesuit mission, but that we would see in the further missions, especially Franciscans and others.
Mm-hmm. So on behalf of everyone here, but also those joining us on live stream, just want to thank you so much for being with us tonight. And I'd like to invite everyone who's present to a reception in the atrium outside immediately following this talk. And I'm sure if you have more questions, Father Sáenz.